The year is 1976. The place is Washington, D.C., and we're at Howard University, specifically their radio station, WHUR.
11:43 in Washington. Wow, 17 minutes before midnight here at WHUR Radio.
A lot was happening outside the walls of this radio station in 1976.
Whether you realize it or not, Black radio is the most powerful form of communication in the Black community.
In local news segments like this one, Black radio's growing influence in D.C. was dissected and analyzed.
It plays an informative role for me. It not only does it offer music, but it offers news, it offers things that are happening in the city.
A lot of these Black radio stations were owned by white people, including several in D.C., with the exception of one station, WHUR. It was owned by Howard University, the most revered historically Black university in the United States.
WHUR, Howard University Radio, even though it is owned by Howard University, it is a commercial radio station. Mm-hmm. And it's a very important radio station in Washington, D.C.
That's Angela Stribling, a longtime TV and radio personality based in D.C. At the time, WHUR was known for playing straight-ahead jazz mixed with broadcasts of speeches, poetry, and news shows. But something changed one summer night in 1976. An intern named Melvin Lindsay, who was a communication major at Howard, was tapped to fill in for an absent host. He was covering the 7 p.m. to midnight time slot, right after The Daily Drum, their popular news show.
11:43 in Washington. Wow, 17 minutes before midnight.
Here's Melvin Lindsay, this intern at Howard University, you know, had never been on the radio. He gets this big opportunity. I don't think anyone foresaw this becoming such a phenomenon.
That night, he ushered in a totally new style of Black radio, one that was intimate and personal.
The next couple of songs I'm going to play have a lot of meaning for me, and I want you to listen to the words. They're dedicated from me to you.
It provides not just music, but also feelings and memories.
It was upscale. It was adult.
And it changed the sound of R&B for decades to come. So what exactly happened on this radio show, and why did it strike a chord with the people that tuned in that night? To know this, you have to understand two things about the 1970s. One, the sonically diverse world of R&B, and two,
class and socioeconomic status.
These two facts are deeply intertwined. In the 1970s, you start to see this finally happen.
More African Americans are able to go to college. Corporate hiring rates start to increase. That Black professional class in particular starts to grow.
And they move to the suburbs at rates that had never been seen before. That's what happened in Washington, D.C. From 1970 to 1980, the Black population in the suburbs increased from 25% to 47%.
And so you see a lot of Black publications, Black media in general, start to pivot to better reflect, and not only reflect, but to shape the identity of what that post-civil rights era Black professional class will look like and sound like. They're now saying, well, how do we soundtrack that group of people?
The good news? They had a lot of music to choose from.
On one level, this 1970s feels like an era of profound freedom musically.
The Fender Rhodes became massively popular. Artists overdosed on the synthesizer. Songs were longer and more experimental. And jazz and funk became one. R&B and soul music, in many ways, continued the trajectory of the politically charged music of the 1960s. The songs that emerged were slow and smooth. The voices that soundtracked them were warm and intimate. Dozens of artists release albums with their take on the sophisticated and mellow-sounding R&B, including the soul singer Smokey Robinson. In 1975, 2 weeks after Chocolate City was released by Parliament, Smokey Robinson released A Quiet Storm. In this article headlined New Lower Voice Cultivated by Smokey Robinson, he states, "I knew that I had to change my style to get where I want to go. So now my sound appears softer and my voice clearer." The title track started like this.
Soft and warm, a quiet storm, quiet as when flowers talk at break of dawn, break of dawn.
Melvin Lindsay's show that night tapped into this growing popularity of smooth R&B ballads, and he mixed it in with previous decades of like-minded jazz. Think Sarah Vaughan.
When stars are bright.
And Nat King Cole.
Unforgettable.
His boss at the time, Kathy Hughes, realized the show's potential. Quick side note, Kathy Hughes is a huge deal. She started Radio One, which is now called Urban One, the largest African-American-owned broadcasting company in the United States. When she started at WHUR in 1973, her goal was simple: get the station to the top of the ratings in the DC market. A huge part of that strategy was appealing to the growing ranks of Black middle-class professionals in the city and the suburbs. Melvin Lindsay's show did just that.
You know, Melvin Lindsay, very elegant, classy guy. So I'm sure he was speaking to people like himself.
Within a year, he graduated, signed a 3-year contract, and had a weekly nighttime show called The Quiet Storm, named after the Smokey Robinson song he started the show with every night. Here's what happened next in Smokey Robinson's own words.
So a guy in Washington, D.C., he had a night radio show. So he made Quiet Storm the theme of his radio show. It took off in Washington, D.C. Other guys started to do it. Then it took off in Baltimore, then New York, then Philadelphia, and it became a radio format.
By 1990, there was at least one Quiet Storm show in every major market.
Soft and warm, the Quiet Storm.
You are the spice of life.
And many of them started with the Smokey Robinson song. And within those late night hours, magic happens.
Let me start by saying, so many people have said that babies were made while their parents were listening to The Quiet Storm. it's just very sexy.
So you have this smooth and soulful R&B and this relaxing DJ who fades in and out with the music. But something else happens that really ties it all together. The call-ins and dedications.
Did you want to hear something?
Yes, yes. Don't stop ever loving me.
In 1980, as A Quiet Storm was building steam across the country, a new genre of music was making its imprint on America and on the radio. Hip-hop.
I'm Mr. Magic. It's 44 degrees on the outside. I'm gonna rock the house down.
But what is interesting is Quiet Storm is still really popular among hip-hop generation. People love Anita Baker to this day.
Anita Baker, you bring me joy. I'm chilling, bumping Anita Baker.
That sweet love Anita Baker was singing about.
Like Electra, let go, Miss Anita Baker.
Perhaps this is why on one of Drake's first mixtapes, he sampled Anita Baker.
You don't really know me like you think you know me.
And 10 years later was still paying homage to the radio format. And perhaps more than any other format, it's not stuck in the past or beholden to the present. It's timeless.
You touch me and suddenly there's rainbow rings. Quiet storm.
When you say The Quiet Storm, it says so much more than a radio show.